Team Pericles, will you please introduce yourselves?
Hello, and thank you so much for having me. My name is Kiran, and I'm studying in class 12.
I'm Sumit from class 12 as well.
Kiran Mohan aspires to be a doctor. She is interested in sketching and listening to music, and she plays badminton. Whereas Sumit Kamble intends to be a physicist. Reading, photography, and swimming are his hobbies. All the best, students. The second team, Team Cicero, please introduce yourselves.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shruti. I'm from class 11.
Good afternoon. My name is Shreya, and I study in class 11.
Shruti Dinayak intends to become either a neurologist or an IAS officer. Her hobbies include reading books, playing guitar, etc. Shreya V. Nagarik wants to be a lawyer. She is a voracious reader and would love to try her luck as a writer as well. Listening to music and drawing is her passion. All the best to both the teams. Let's start the first round, and the round is the presentation round. And for the presentation round, Kiran Mohan will speak for the motion.
It is a proud moment for me to salute my friends, respected teachers, and the Dodds-Manship of Atomic Energy Education Society, the honor of which equates with the guard of honor of President Barack Obama, led by Wing Commander Pooja Thakur, a 21-gun salute at the majestic presidential palace, and the seamless cultural diversity of my country, with an all-women's contingent drawn from the three services the next day, as the theme was Nari Shakti, Woman Power. 18 June 2016 was a historic day in the Indian Pride of Valour to induct and announce its first batch of women pilots going for a training of Style 3 on Hawk Advanced Jet Trainers. Agni Chaturvedi, Mohana Singh and Bhavna Kant will fly supersonic warplanes. The commissioning of women not only has top bankers like Arundhati Bhattacharya, Shikha Sharma, Chanda Kochar, Paralympians like Deepa Malik, who won silver at the shot put, silver shuttler P.V. Sindhu, bronze wrestler Sakshi Malik at the Rio Olympics, Bardish Chagar, a Sikh woman who won elections in the Canada's House of Commons to become an MP, Louise Richardson, the first woman Vice Chancellor of Oxford in the 900 years of its history, Rinana Jabbala, UN panelist of Women's Economic Development, clearly state the importance of women's role in sustainable development goals. From being mere green nuns to Amazonian guards, or serving as civil defense volunteers in anti-riot procedures, the struggle to rise to the post of volunteers and brigadiers has been a long war against cultural attitudes. It required an attitudinal change to finally announce that women will be allowed to serve in commissioned forces. Nepal's People Liberation Army, a guerrilla army, has a 30% female quota. Even Pakistan has trained their women in sniper, airborne, and infantry warfare. Many German women shot down thousands of Allied warplanes during World War II. Sabiha was the first female Turkish aviator in bombardment missions. Captain Nicola Goddard became the first Canadian woman to be killed in combats in Afghanistan in 2006. In 2016, the title of this debate is apt, as most of the developed and the developing countries will open gates for women in commissioned forces. US Defense Secretary Ash Carter too has promised this on the lines of India's Defense Minister Shri Manohar Parrikar to raise an all-women's battalion and stationing them on warships. Dear friends, if there is a he for she to support equal footing in both the worlds, then the day is not far when all the service chiefs shall be women, breaking the initial resistance of male-dominated soldiers. But first, at least give us a woman battalion of women leading women. We will win wars and glories for our motherland, which itself searches for Veeranganaye, the brave hearts who since prehistoric times have been subjected to Sati and Johar. Thanking you all with sparkling anticipation.
That was Kiran, and Kiran was speaking for the motion. The second speaker is Kumari Shruti Dinayak, and she'll be speaking against the motion.
Respected judges, teachers, fellow debaters, and all my friends. Good afternoon, everyone. Ever since the origin of human being on Earth, civilizations have survived by adopting the fundamental principle of division of labor. Man was the hunter, gatherer, and protector. The woman, on the other hand, was the anchor of the family. She was the origin of man as a child. She nurtured and nourished the family. Coming to the topic at hand, I think that all of us present here have misunderstood what a woman really is. We have misunderstood what the strength is and where it lies. Instead of asking ourselves if women should form a part of defense forces, let us look at the job profile of a soldier. A soldier is the one who guards the borders of a country in extreme condition, forever alert on a lookout for enemy from beyond. He builds himself into an impregnable human shield to protect the citizens of the country. A soldier is the one who stays awake so that the rest of us can sleep. You really believe that a woman is built to face all of this? Is a body equipped to face the brunt of the harsh weather and horrendous circumstances? No. According to National Strength and Condition USA, a report of theirs says that women generally have 2/3 of muscle mass as compared to a man. A man has 90% greater upper body strength and 65% greater lower body strength. A woman is unique. She is a separate entity. And by making her be what a man is, you're limiting her. You're not letting out her true potential. Yes, she's strong. Stronger than any man can be. A woman has the mental strength to sacrifice herself to protect her family. But let me remind you, my friend, the defense forces is not a sacrificial animal. The strength of a woman lies in her emotions and brains. They are fantastic multitaskers and can perform jobs that involve critical thinking. They can be amazing CEOs, bankers, doctors, the list goes on. They can even be strategists for the defense forces. But by inducting women into defense forces, not only are we undermining their true potential, but also diluting the capability and the strength of the armed forces. Yes, my friends, I oppose the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Shruti. I invite the third speaker of the day. That is Sumedh Kamble. Sumedh Kamble is going to speak for the motion.
Being a part of the military life could also mean leaving a small piece of your heart all over the world. Go girls, not all heroes are men, so don't be the victims classified as crazy anymore. I see a Sikh warrior, Bhago Mai. I see an Afghan lieutenant, Nulifur Rahmani. I witness an army veteran, Dana and Berza marching ahead. And also the quick and agile spies of the IBN Raw in you. Your right to serve deserves as much respect as men get. Revered panel of judges, dignitaries and all my dear friends. Tomorrow is the concluding day of World Heritage Week, and it is also the week to remember reclaiming women's indigenous heritage through their courageous history. I speak for the motion. This world every year on 8th of March celebrates International Women's Day with a sole determination to commemorate women's achievements, to empower them, and to acknowledge the special status they deserve in the society, but forgets to give due credit to the bereft staff which created this all. Women were impartial while gifting a populace to this world, and God was impartial while gifting this land to us. But we chose to draw boundaries on it, divide it, tax and terrorize its people. It was the brainchild of a male world who coined the term defense, or you may say at war. But only men must fight and women must weep. There's a little to earn and many to keep, has been a myth propagated by the male world. I find it bizarre that I have to remind you of warriors such as Zenobia, the 1077th anti-aircraft regiment of the then USSR consisting of teenage girls, or Yevdokia Zavali, a Soviet nurse, soldier and a Marine commander who was wounded 4 times and awarded 40 medals during the World War II. Can we deny the valor of Rani Lakshmibai, Begum Hazrat Mahal, Razia Sultan, or Rani Velu Naichia? When I say this with the confidence of the generation next collective voice, that if women are already radioactively combatant in the Indian Army Corps of Electronics, Mechanical Engineers, at Signals, Service and Ordnance Corps, Intelligence and Judge Advocate branch for the Indian Army, almost all the branches of Navy, flying and technical branches of IAF, and stand alongside men shoulder to shoulder in all the branches of Coast Guards, they need not wait any longer for the age-old myths to be thrown right out of the window. In a country where women occupy almost half, that is 48.46% of the population, we just cannot assume that defense is a male affair. Women must have more roles in security and peacekeeping, and moreover, the nature of military methodology has changed drastically to smart technology, surgical strikes, precision airstrikes, and bombing. Yuka post-Cold War strategic leadership, negotiations, and conflict resolution tactics can be the technical and instrumental warfare headed by women force. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumit. The last speaker of the senior group is Shreya V. Nagri, and she is going to speak against the motion.
Once said, "I think women are foolish to pretend that they are equal to men. They are far superior and have always been." Having said that, my dear friends, if we judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree or a bird by its capability to swim, not only are we doing a great disservice to it, but are also guilty of badly misusing our capability of rational thought. Coming to the topic at hand, I think we have misunderstood that a woman shouldn't whether a woman should be in a defense force or not. We have taken stances based on personal views and mindsets. We have not taken stances based on logic. I am standing here in front of you today to remove these preposterous misconceptions and faulted arguments that are afloat and burn them down for the benefit of truth. Number one, women can do all physical tasks as well as men do. That's so not true. If it were to be so, I wonder why the Indian Defence Forces have set such appallingly low standards in physical fitness for the selection of women, and why they are just managing to scrape through. Women were made by nature physically weaker than men. Don't get me wrong, women are wonderful creatures. They were made to be kind, gentle, beautiful, compassionate, and nurturing. They were made to create, not to destroy. Number two. Physical fitness has no role to play in modern fighting. That would have been true had we been talking about a country like America, who's got the tech to blow the enemies into outer space sitting in their war rooms. But this is the Indian Defence Forces we are talking about. Our soldiers still need to actually cross the border to blow up the enemy in surgical strikes. So not for women. Number three, if women can fight in bodies such as LTTE and Naxalite forces, then why not in the services? God, are we not comparing a professional fighting army to a band of guerrillas? Even so, the women in LTTE and Naxalite forces are generally formed the suicide squads alongside children. Doesn't really apply here, does it? And the list goes on, with each argument going down before it raises its head. Friends, let's make no mistake about one thing. The strength of a woman is tremendous. No man on earth can equal it, let alone being better. But this strength of hers, unlike a man, is not in her muscles. It's in her mind and in her heart. A woman has the emotional strength to nurse and to nourish, but not the sinew of a bull. The Indian army is not just a bunch of men. They together are like the Himalayas, forming an impenetrable wall, guarding us and protecting us while we sleep. There is no cause, call it gender equality, justice to the weak, or experimental jingoism, for which I am willing to punch holes into our protective chrysalis and expose our families to the dangers from beyond. I rest my case.
Thank you, Shreya. Both the teams have completed the presentation round. Now let's move on to the rebuttal round. In the rebuttal round, the first question will be posed by Team Pericles. Team Pericles to Team Cicero.
Not only one. Not only one, but two. First, Lieutenant Hayshaver and Christy Green to pass the regulation mail. First Lieutenant Shea Havers and Captain Christine Grish to pass the rigorous military training program called the Range School. So you want to talk about strength as well, okay. Now, they have shown the world that they can endure harsh environments at Reading as well, if not better than men do. And just to remind, the Ranger School has a pass out percentage of 40.5%, that is even less than half. So you mean to say we cannot find more tough women like Sakshi Malik, Kanam Maleshwari in a population, in a female population of 58.46 million, 586 million. Forget about passing tests or trainings. What justification do you give for not even letting them apply and prove themselves?
Okay, that was a wonderful question, but thing is that by science itself, we are not just emotionally explaining it to you. We are not using our emotions to guide us. By science, it has been proven that a woman does not have as much physical strength as a man does. You spoke about Sakshi Malik, Karnam Maleshwari, and other examples. You said that they have shown themselves, they have proven themselves. But I think you failed to see that they were fighting against other women. They were not fighting against men. Were they? Sakshi Malik, she competed against a woman. She didn't compete against a man. But because if she competes against a man, you know who will fare better. And that's not her fault. That's no woman's fault. It was made by nature. Due to evolution, men fared physically better than women. Women, in more ways than one, were emotionally more capable than men were. Let's see.
I would like to ask a simple question to my learned opponents. Can I have the right to equality in honor and martyrdom? If yes, ladies first. If no, then what is more honorable? Discrimination, domestic violence, acid attacks, or a martyrdom in the line of duty? I have the right to live.
Yeah, will you please repeat the question?
Can I have the right to equality in martyrdom? If yes, ladies first. If no, then what is more justified? Domestic violence, acid attacks, or a martyrdom in the line of duty? I have the right to live.
Qualities. They are fantastic multitaskers. They can do calculations at feet. They have this amazing quality of critical thinking. Why can't they recognize themselves and has these qualities that they already possess? Why are we looking at just martyrdom? Why do we want to send women where they really don't belong? Because we won't be celebrating them. Because, as I said, their qualities are different. Their nature is different and they are unique. They are a separate entity. They are supposed to be gentle, sensitive, and they are intelligent.
There are many other fields where they can actually establish themselves. Where you should actually send. Now, because we are speaking about gender, you should send them where they belong, where they can give their 100%. A man can give his 100% in the army. A woman can give her 100% being a teacher, a doctor, a civil servant, an administrative officer. I feel that by sending her somewhere where even if it is not her fault, she can't give her 100%, she won't belong there. And also it will be a threat to national security. And I feel that national security is the most important issue at hand.
That's the end of the second round, the rebuttal round. Dila. Teacher Seru.
About Rani Lakshmibai, Razia Sultan, even we believe that they were wonderful warriors. But what this it was forced to fight in a war because that was the situation that they had there. Can you tell me how this is going to help in our defense forces?
Yeah, as I mentioned, she does not only prove that women have the ability to fight when the time comes. And as you have said in your answers, that women does not have the physical strength that is required to defend our forces. Well, let me tell you that the defense forces does not just comprise of the infantry that are posted at the battlegrounds or battlefields. The army has its nerve at the command center. Women today have proof. To be high officers in JAG, that is Judge Advocates General's branch. So if they are capable of determining who is right and wrong in action of duty, then I pretty well feel that women can be admirals or marshals giving orders to men on the battleground, which can help strengthen our national security.
You spoke about them being field marshals, them officers and everything. First of all, the defense forces are a majority of people who work on the ground. That is, they are the ones who do the task like the infantry is consists of a very large portion. There's about only 2-3% of people who work in strategy and intelligence. And when you my question is that when you are talking about them being officers and field marshals, aren't you discriminating against men? Because you just want them to be officers, you don't want them to participate as soldiers and in the infantry.
So you saying that women are only officers is wrong. Women are today being employed at harsh conditions. The Indo-Siachen border, for example, to be taken, women are hired there. In terms of technicians, engineers, at supporting infantry branches. Women do serve in rigorous conditions alongside men. They do not ask for extra time to rest, nor they are given any. Okay, just to give an example of Lieutenant Suzanne Etty, who served while she was pregnant, never asked for extra rest, nor she was given. So saying that women are physically weak and cannot endure the situation, the harsh situations, I would truly say that would be insulting to a woman who is now standing at the borders and protecting us.
This 2.5 to 3.5% commission for women in the army. Have they ever given her a chance to prove their military prowess to the world? And let me tell you one thing, war is always the last option. Defense also means non-violent options and arbitration. And women are an expert in negotiation and arbitration. I can give you an example of Pakistani woman, Meena Rabbani, who is the 26th Foreign Minister of Pakistan, was an expert in bilateral talks and multilateral talks. And also 2 lakh crore is the defense budget of her country. So can't we think of a Costa Rican approach like to avoid wars through a multilateral talk and instead spend that money on issues like poverty and healthcare, education? Women in Indian defense may try to bring such a role, may try to create such a situation if they are given a chance of multilateral talks.
Thank you. And with that, we come to the end of the rebuttal round. And the next round again goes back to the judges. The judges' round with Rohan sir.
when we saw this topic, I mean, we had clearly made up our mind. But I think the crux of this panel was about the amount of research that you have done. And I think that is a point that sir brought out before. And I think the team that will win today has clearly, you know, surpassed the other team in terms of the research work that they have done. They have given actual case studies. You know, I would like to first say that I really appreciate very small things. You know, I observe small things. You know, you started off by saying fellow debaters, and I think that is part of the professional debate etiquette. And you know, that's very good. I think in the finals we would like to see. And I think both of you are very, very sweet, especially you. You know, it's so pleasing. You know, when you speak, there are some people who have different styles. Somebody, you know, are very assertive. Some people, but I think. You know, to make a point, you don't have to always shout, and both of you have, you know, with very elegance, I think that's a great way, that's another style, actually. So, congratulations about that. You know, I would like to actually see, I mean, this is, I hope, this is my devil's desire, like you say. I want to see you, this team, in the finals with the gender equality against. I hope you get that, because you know you guys have obviously done very good. But I hope that you get gender equality against, and if at all, yeah, it can happen. See, I think another thing about this defense force, again going back to the key words. See, defense force, I think at the very outset is just one of the several vocations that you have in the labor market. So if the labor market does not distinguish between women, and today we see that women are in all fields, what makes the difference? And I was, I think, looking for that kind of a, you know, response, that what makes the defense sector so very special that women cannot enter? I think, Shreya, you were pretty much given the responsibility of defending the indefensible, but I think you've done a fantastic job. I don't know what the final outcome will be, because you know everybody has got very, very high marks in this particular panel, and it's very difficult for us. And this particular panel is going to throw up some serious surprises, okay? Because we, three of us, for the first time, are disagreeing for the first time today, okay? I just have a question, two questions. One for Sumit. So, do you agree that men could actually play a role in medical nursing in the army?
Yeah, I think sure they can. And to be
do you conceptualize yourself? I mean, if are you interested in joining the army, the armed forces?
No, not really.
Okay, a friend of yours who probably is interested, because you spoke with a lot of conviction. I just don't understand. Do you think you'll be fine if you know, man is a nurse in the? I mean, serving at the.
Yeah, it's not difficult to see a man serving as a nurse, and I don't know what in the Indian context do we have that we have set up particular jobs for the genders, because. As we are seeing across the world, those walls have been broken down, because to be seen in the US Army, there are medics and nurses who are males.
Right.
Yeah. So I don't see a reason that that would not come down to the Indian armed forces, Navy, military.
So westernization is not always bad. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of things to learn from the West.
Yes.
Right?
So if you want to take things, like, why not just take good things first?
Okay. Shreya, you mentioned about science. Science says that women are biologically weak. I think you should read up a new school of, you know, that is emerging called Feminist Science Studies, and how feminists actually, and that's why I said, and there are small things like, you know, use of he or she, because we assume that, you know, science gives us the truth, but there's also another side of the story, and that's what I think we as social scientists do. Someone said women don't belong to this thing. Now the question is, I think, which you probably touched upon is, do women at all long to be there? Okay. Are even women interested in joining the armed forces? I think the question is not about whether you are making space, but whether a woman has a choice. Now the woman can say, I don't care about joining. She might say, I'm just saying, women might say, I'm more intelligent, so I don't want to lose my, you know, life in the, you know, on the battlefield. But the question is, who decides? Okay, and if you're talking about development as freedom, and that's something that Amartya Sen talks about, it's about having the freedom to choose, yeah? Quickly, some points which I think we could have been addressed in this debate. It could have made it a little more, you know, balanced. But both teams have tried very hard. I was looking more about mention of sexual harassment, you know, which is happening, which happens with women who are in the army by men, because it's a very, very masculine culture, and you know, even the women who are there find it very, very, you know, difficult to survive that male culture or the whole locker room speak, as it may. Also, you know. Women are mostly recruited, so while there is recruitment happening, I think a lot of it is only at the level of rhetoric. It's not about women just being there,
but what are they doing? So that's why I asked you.
Women,
though in the armed forces, are actually nurses or they're teachers, not so many of them get part of the infantry.
I think as you know, people, young people who probably many of us might join the armed forces, I think it's a great thing to do. We should also, and the women who join, I think it's about making a more enabling environment. Where this whole male hierarchy or this whole male domination, we address those issues. It's not so much about women being there. And the question is, are women being there because they want to be there? And the larger question is, what exact role are women playing? Or are men also ready to undergo a gender role shift? Because that essential and the basis of this is, dealing with patriarchy. So I think nobody mentioned that. But of course, that we expect in a college level debate. For a school level debate, this was outstanding. Okay, it is excellent. I think both these teams are fantastic. I want to see both teams in the final. I don't know how that will happen, but excellent. Congratulations to both of you.
Like to ask you, do you feel freedom to choose should come before national security? When I spoke about science and science proving that women are not as physically strong as men, so it's not their fault, but they can't give their 100%. That's what I said. So how does it matter whether they want to be there or don't want?
I think we'll have the discussion the day experience childbirth. Ask people who have experienced childbirth. I think that requires immense mental and physical courage. When the baby comes out, and obviously it's incomparable. But I think women, I don't buy the argument that women are biologically inferior, whatever. Okay, that's my view. I don't know this thing. Like I said, you are defending the indefensible. Very few people, but you've still done a fabulous job of defending the indefensible. And clearly, they were way more well-researched. But like I said, you expect surprises in this panel. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I don't think we have much time left with us, because all of us, we are all raring to go for lunch, isn't it? We would like to have lunch in the first place itself. But still, I would like to give some of my points. First thing is, for the first time, I think, since this is the last of the food debates that we had this morning, for the first time, all those points were taken care, well taken care. The speed part, the skill is always there with all the participants. The speed part was taken very well care of by the participants. The volume was at very, very soothing and moderate level. And I was particularly impressed with the attitude of the participants, with the kind of elan they spoke. I did not feel that we are listening to a debate, just as if you're sitting on the corridor of your home and you are having a discussion with your friends or your neighbors, something like that. So it was a wonderful experience for me personally. Now, going back to the debate part as such, we were talking about debate. What is debate? Debate is a kind of structured argument which is done, which is presented in a formal manner. Now, what does a debate give us, basically? Debate, if you ask me, gives us two important things. One is, it teaches us to be a better communicator, how to speak in a better way, in a better manner, number one. And number two, which is very important, which I saw right here, I experienced that. It teaches us to create and place an argument when we know that inside ourselves, we are not supporting that argument. Still, we place that argument and we are doing an argument. Although, I really, really appreciate the efforts of especially Shreya, because she is a girl. She will grow up to be a woman. And she was saying that, defense is not really a place for the ladies, for the women folk. Maybe inside her, she was not really supporting this motion, but she was trying her best to do a wonderful job in an hour. And that was really appreciated. Because it's really, really kind of experience that will put you in a very good state in your future days and your future life. Now, to put forward some questions. First question to this, especially to Master Sumay. And I'm really scared because now the video camera is right in front of us. Earlier it was here, now it is really facing me. So I'm really scared. In fact, for this question is very personal. So I would request the video recorder to kindly switch off the video recording when this is being asked. Now, suppose you are a father and daughter. Okay? Now, whom would you like to send to the Defence Force? Your son or your daughter?
My son.
that for me would solely depend on who wants to go.
I believe. Okay. Okay, let me take it. Right. Okay. Now I come to this team. I again salute both of you because you were really, as Sir had put it, you were defending the indefensible, but still you did in a wonderful manner speak. Especially Shreya, that was really wonderful. Now, for you, I would have said that you would have gained some more weight had you touched upon the topic. You would have read in between the line, that is, recruitment of women in defense forces does not necessarily mean that the women will go to the border and fight. Defense force doesn't only consist of soldiers who are fighting at the border. There are a number of other ingredients in the defense forces. Even doctors and nurses are also in the defense forces. Many other kind of work are there in the defense forces. And women can very well fit into those. It's not that a woman has to go to the border to fight as a soldier. Defense force doesn't necessarily mean that. Well, the bigger part of the defense force is, of course, fighting at the border. But it's not everything, it's not all. So, large part of the defense force, if not everything, if not the major part, is also the auxiliary part of it, the supporting part of it, which is also equally important, which also does an equally important job as what a soldier does when he is fighting at the border. So, you would have touched this point. Anyway, once again, a fantastic experience for me. I really went to my good old school days, and thanks to all the participants for giving this wonderful morning to me. And thank you, Madan Rao sir, for inviting me for being a judge on this particular event, which is really a wonderful experience. It was a breath of fresh air for me. And really, I would like to thank and congratulate all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shreya. Thank you, for me, as a woman who appeared twice to enter into army 22 years ago. But despite the fact that I was so emotionally connected to this topic, and when you were defending, still I appreciated, as everyone mentioned, Shreya, you were putting forth your point. But then there are some points which I was telling to Rohan, you could have, like, they did a thorough research in terms of what's going on, what are the strengths, and so on and so forth. You could have really read each and every word. My people would have spoken about the discrimination which is going on within. For what purpose they are recruited? What is the status women are getting within? So that could have, that kind of research would have led your debate in a different way. Recruitment for what cause? What are the roles they are playing? How it is useful, not useful? How it can be redefined? Because it's a broad-based. So the recruitment is not against recruitment. For what purpose it's happening also you could have. I mean, the homework was excellent from their side. But then, the way you were confidently putting forth your views, I appreciate.